Welcome to the data-centric era. Please mute your cell phones. And welcome to the stage, partner, Fraud Investigation and Dispute Services at Ernst Young, Mr. Vince Walden.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. My name is Vince Walden, as mentioned, partner at Ernst Young. I'm based out of our New York office in our fraud investigations practice. And I specifically focus on forensic data analytics, integrating the leading kind of anti-fraud tests and compliance methodologies and analytics to help fight fraud and on investigations. I'd like to invite two of my colleagues. My first colleague, Nadia Brandon, could you come up? She's an executive director out of our San Francisco office with a master's in econometrics, and she's our lead statistician. And my other colleague, Jason Brenier, who's our senior manager, he's our lead data scientist with a PhD in text mining from Stanford. And what's interesting is I think about this, you know, I'm the traditional CPA, finance background, accounting type guy. But look how kind of the team is changing within our group. And again, we're with an accounting firm, right? A whole bunch of CPAs work there. Not so much. I've got a data scientist and econometrics. These are the types of skill sets that need to come together as we kind of fight and tackle fraud in this new technology era. So it's a different game out there, and we look forward to sharing how big data is really changing the game in how we go about fraud investigations with our new technologies and hardware, new technologies and software. And we want to just give you some ideas to take back to your organizations and mainly your clients as you think about their risks and their landscapes. Any comments you want to add to that?
No.
No? All right, we'll get right in. Yeah, very good. So here's our current risk landscape. And you know, if you're a general counsel, which you're not, or internal auditors or compliance officers, you're very familiar with this. But most people are not. But here's what we're dealing with. Your clients are doing business in these countries. If for global organizations, if you're doing business in companies that are red, you have a risk around global corruption. And what I'm particularly referring to is the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. It's against the law to bribe government officials. And in some cases, in countries like the United Kingdom, it's just against the law to bribe in general. The risks there, though, is that the sanctions and the penalties can be quite significant. In fact, just about 2 weeks ago, the company Diebold Manufacturing just paid a $48 million settlement. One of the largest ones about a couple years ago was Siemens. They paid over $1.6 billion in settlement and fines. Again, you think about not only just corruption and bribery, but in the pharmaceutical industry with off-label marketing, J&J just paid a $2.2 billion settlement. The fines are huge. In fact, I think just yesterday or the day before, J.P. Morgan announced a multi-billion dollar settlement in the resolution of the home market, the mortgage meltdown. These are the issues that are out there. And when we think about compliance and compliance monitoring, we need to get our hands dirty with some analytics. It's not just about giving nice policies and training procedures to our staff and employees. It's really about bringing some tangible analytics. And that's where hardware and software come into play. And that's what we're going to talk about.
When you look at the map behind us, you'll see that some of the areas on the map are red. You know, places like North Korea, Afghanistan, Congo. There is quite a bit of risk that the global companies are facing in those countries, particularly the developing world is not so kind to financial institutions. We know of a number of global fraud rings where within literally a week, 400 different bank accounts have been compromised, 24 countries, 23 million has been stolen by an organized ring of fraudsters. Financial institutions, other areas where we see a lot of fraud is pharmaceuticals. And the third industry that is facing quite a bit of risk is energy industry.
And you can imagine if you're doing an investigation in these different countries and you're collecting data on the ground from these different countries, that many different languages are going to be represented in that data. both in structured and unstructured data, as well as semi-structured data. So we're seeing an increasing need to have capabilities in the areas of natural language processing, computational linguistics, text mining. In a recent project investigation that we were involved in, which we'll talk a little bit more about later, we collected data from 16 different countries, and we had more than 70 different languages that were represented in the data, because a lot of these clients that we work with are global in nature. So even if you've collected an email server from, you know, Congo, you're going to have English represented, you're going to have all of the European languages represented. And so it definitely creates a very interesting situation when you get down to the details and you develop analytics to support the investigation.
Yeah, and you think about that. How does that play into the hardware and the software needs? When you have millions and millions of communications, whether it's payment data or email communications or instant messagings, all coming into your servers, and you have to run it against scores and scores of different languages, how do you pull out the entity extractions or the topic models of all those different languages to find that improper payment? Meanwhile, the regulators are beating down your back, and the FBI or the Department of Justice is at their door, and the Wall Street Journal is writing about you at the same time saying company's going down. That's the type of pressure that these companies are under in these types of investigative matters. Meanwhile, the demands on IT can be pretty extensive. I'm going to rewind the clock here. Some of you may have remember this book. Back in the 90s, remember when Andy Grove at Intel wrote about, in that Only the Paranoid Survive, that 10x factor? You think about that. He called it the strategic inflection point, the game-changing technology breakthrough that would throw out all the rules of traditional business or that you were used to. In the accounting and investigation worlds, and I think as we think about Hadoop and some of the map-reduced technologies that are out there, it's been a game changer for us accountants. We are throwing out a lot of our traditional accounting tests, the traditional rules-based things, the things that we used to do with, we love the general ledger and the text mining or the analysis of numbers in the data. We're thinking about so many new data sources now. It really is a game changer, and it's probably a 10x factor, because I know we're going 10 times faster, and and the data is 10 times larger, is it not?
Yeah. Absolutely.
If you think about it, we do live in the data-centric era today. 90% of the data that we are dealing with today have been created in the last 2 years. And of course, the speed is going to accelerate. We really live in the world of things. Gartner predicted that by 2020, every person on Earth is going to have 6 devices connected to the internet. And those devices are constantly talking and sending messages.
Yeah, down to the shoes and your refrigerator and your watch and all that stuff.
Absolutely. And as the volume, the variety, the velocity of all this data increases, we're going to have to really start thinking about optimizing both the software and the hardware when we devise analytics and we develop a strategy for analyzing all this. It's really important for all of us to begin to think about a more holistic design to the solution and bring to the table all of the capabilities that we have.
Yeah. So concept one, especially in fraud investigations, is this 10x factor. It's a game changer. And we're rethinking the rules around how we approach these investigations. And this is just an example. And Nadia, can you take us through kind of some of these examples? This is just what we're seeing in our labs.
First, I would like to start with laying the ground, what is the current state of affairs in fraud detection and fraud investigations. Typically, we are still bound by relational databases. It is current status quo that we analyze scores of financial data, ERP systems, CRM systems, customer relationship management systems. And of course, we are limited by the abilities of the SQL Server, SAP, Oracle, in terms of how much data we can ingest, with what speeds we can analyze it, and what type of algorithms we can use to detect fraud. However, coming of a big data and prevalence of the technologies like Hadoop have allowed us to ask completely different questions and include much broader sets of analytics in our day-to-day work.
Yeah. I just add, you know, if you look at these numbers, and again, I'm the accountant. These are some of the tests that I would typically have to run on an investigation or even a proactive matter where I'm looking for fraud and, you know, looking for just duplicative payments. On 10 million records, that SQL server, it had 144 gigabytes of memory. It was a pretty good SQL server, but it timed out after 4 hours. Yet, in that Hadoop platform, it was a 9-node Hadoop. I'm not talking like Google's engine. I just had 9 nodes. But wow, a minute 34 seconds as compared to timing out after 4 hours. Or I ran some keyword searches on some journal entries where we had suspicious words like friend fee or release expense or special payment or incentive pay. That's how people paid, you know, they would categorize bribes or corruption payments. And I would search those words, 3.6 million. It took me 3 hours, 36 minutes on that one server, 2 minutes and 8 seconds in that Hadoop platform. What a game changer. And again, this wasn't even hardware tuned. This was just software tuned.
Remember, Vince, commodity hardware.
Yeah, this was
on
running.
On our Hadoop cluster.
Yeah,
so
just think about how we can enhance this. That point to, and Jason, I know you'll talk about this later, it allows us to do so much more in terms of iterations and fine-tuning that is allowed, you know, to get much better results for our investigative matters, because I can now run multiple iterations rather than having to wait 3 hours and 36 minutes to get my results. This gets us to the next concept as it slowly expands onto your screen. Have you ever heard of Parkinson's Law? Anybody ever heard of Parkinson's Law? It's a technology term. We've heard of Moore's Law and all the other technology ones, but here's one. This came out in like 1955 in the Economist magazine. Parkinson's Law says work expands as to fill the time available for its completion. It wasn't necessarily talking about technology at the time, but boy, does it have practical applications now. As we think about what work and what our analytics and what our day jobs are changing as technology allows us to be that much more efficient with our time, to allow new questions and new work to happen to fill the void. So it's not like we're going to have all this free time on our hands by having a query that took 4 hours get done in 3 minutes. It's not like I'm going to go home early every day. It's just that I'm going to do that much more work and I can do that much more analytics to find fraud, which is what I love and think about all the time.
And advances in hardware are going to give us the opportunity to not just do one pass through that data, but to really dynamically update all of the models that we apply here. I mean, it gives us so much more time to dig so much deeper into the data that we have. It's really exciting to have that as a possibility. And again, going back to the Hadoop, when you have multiple servers and you're doing parallel processing, imagine swapping out some of that commodity hardware with some supercharged hardware that would allow you to really go that much deeper.
Yeah. Yeah, and we've seen some technology at this show that's looked pretty promising in that area, too.
Absolutely.
So think about that. So I wanted to introduce that concept because the 10x change allows us to do 10 times more work. And, you know, and Parkinson's Law is keeping us honest and not sending us home early. It's just that our work is going to be completely changing.
I have one more example
for that.
Typically, or historically, in a lot of these investigations that we've been involved in, given the resources that we had available, both in terms of human resources and technological resources, the model was to do some sampling and review some of those transactions, mm-hmm. review a representative sample of an email corpus. But now we have the opportunity to really apply these tests to every single data point that we have in the collection.
That is huge, and that's that 100% sampling. Nadia, right. Take us through this.
Yeah, and of course, it's a fairly risky proposition as a statistician to do sampling when you're trying to detect rare events. Because just by a sheer chance, you're going to miss something. And typically, you know, fraud detection is really the work of finding a needle in a haystack, looking for something that doesn't happen that often. And prevalence of big data allowed us to to really change the way that we do things. If traditionally, a lot of fraud detection software is very much algorithmic in nature. You know, we identify this is how the fraudster is going to behave, this is what he potentially might do, this is what a bad transaction might look like, and we try to imitate it. However, what's the problem with it? Well, the problem with it is that everything evolves. Fraudsters are always ahead, a step ahead of the detection software. They come up with new, a lot more sophisticated schemes and the ways to go around it. And particularly in the recent years, I think the number of break-ins since break-ins into corporate networks have increased 60% in the last 2 years. We are not now, we can't just be doing fraud detection the same way that we have been doing before. We need to use statistical methods. For example, you know, various methods for anomaly detection to stay ahead of the fraudsters, to learn before and allow machines to learn before fraudsters can trick us. Use of visual analytics is an incredibly powerful tool that we have been using. Interactive dashboards work very well for some of our clients. We also talk about pattern matching, and I'll give you an example of a case that I worked on where it was a hack pump and dump scheme. And what hack pump and dump is, if you're probably familiar with the traditional pump and dump fraud, where a fraudster would purchase, say, stock, something that is thinly traded and is not worth very much, and then they pump the stock, they advertise it and tell everybody what a great buy it is, so you have to, you know, come in and buy it too. What that does, it artificially elevates the price of the stock, and then they, at the height of the price, they come in and dump it, and of course make a lot of money. Well, now, you know, modern day fraudsters, they don't need to you know, spend a lot of time advertising. All they do, they just break into your online account, and then they sell off whatever securities you have, and then they buy some thinly traded security, and then they do the same thing for a lot of other accounts. While they're holding the thinly traded securities in their own account, somewhere overseas, there is no way really to connect those activities together. Wow. Right, and then of course when they artificially elevated that price, they dump it. So when we were investigating this, what we noticed was going to happen that a compromised account will have a break-in, attempted login, and then with the same interval of time, another attempted login, failed login, and then within the same exact interval of time, another failed login, and so on and so forth. So had the brokerage firm have identified that pattern, that was happening in one account, and then the same attempts have been happening in another account, they will be able to stop it before it actually happened. What actually happened, those were botnets, right? Bots that were trying to compromise the account and see if they can get in. And once successful break-in happened, a login from another computer, from a completely different IP, a different country, actually, you know, attacks were perpetrated predominantly from Russia and China, there was a successful login and then a transaction and a wire out or a trade happened.
Wow. You know, Nadi, you think about that, again, going back to the types of analytics and the processing speed needed to stay ahead of those patterns, mm-hmm. that's where the game changing is. Mm-hmm. Being able to build that algorithm to spot that requires use of multiple data sources coming in, looking for those patterns, multiple high volume, velocity, and even what we find when we think about variety, which is that third component of big data, structured and unstructured data. When you think about fraud, corrupt intent most often lives in the unstructured world. Text. People, you know, you'll find corrupt intent, not so much in the numbers as much, but in the text, in the words that they are describing to book payments or to inappropriately expense travel and entertainment or to pay a bribe. or to book transactions. And that's something that really is a game changer for how we've integrated and changed up our analytics. This is where, you know, when we think about the new questions we can ask of the data, and this is where I challenge you to think differently about the data that you're using. And again, you're probably not fraud investigators, but thinking about what you're currently analyzing in your data warehouses, and how can it be different by incorporating new data sources, and what new questions can you ask of the data? As a, you know, as an investigator, it's really exciting. There are so many things that we haven't even thought of yet when we can combine these multiple data sources. So for example, when I'm looking for a risk profile, for when I want to look for risky vendors or risky employees within a company, you know, I can look at the email and instant messaging communications. I can look at external news feeds on third parties that I'm dealing with. I can look at social media of the subject and what they've been posting out on Facebook or what have you. Of course, I would look at the ERP and financial systems and how they've been behaving, what kind of expenses are they submitting, who's getting paid, what's their sales activity, et cetera, and looking at that and pulling that in. I'm able to then ask questions like, we've noticed that we've paid this vendor $150,000 over the past 6 months, and that vendor has been written up in the Wall Street Journal for some fraud scheme somewhere overseas, and there's communications with the head procurement officer in the company with the CEO of that company talking about how they're going off and going to the golf course and having a good time and planning some inappropriate stuff, and the social media is the person's blogging about it. That is a risk profile that before, had I just looked at accounts payable in isolation, I probably wouldn't have caught, and that vendor wouldn't have come up on my risk radar. Even for ourselves, I mean, when we're working with clients and even our own firm, where we're risk ranking our employees from highest to lowest risk based on an overall risk profile of an individual. So imagine taking 55,000 employees and running their travel and entertainment expenses through. Someone is going to score number one, right?
Let's hope it's not you.
I checked mine. I'm like 16,500.
As you all go home after the conference.
But think about it. This is what's going to be changing. Yeah. And, you know, that first one, and again, what this does, and again, just you can apply this, think about your own business or your clients that you're working with. If it's employees or whatever you're trying to risk rank, that's the key trend. Because someone is going to always score, or someone or something is always going to score the highest based on multiple attributes. And what that's going to do is it helps really us do an effective job in that I'm not so interested in the one person who abused his expense policy once and maybe booked an extra hotel room out of policy. Big deal. That's not where you're going to get the recoveries. I'm looking for the gross offender who is consistently booking out of policies, consistently entertaining people at, you know, gentlemen's clubs, consistently doing inappropriate things, and duplicating expenses and trying to filter money out of my organization. That's the risk profile by pulling together multiple data sources. And again, this is just an idea of whatever data sources that you are currently analyzing in your day-to-day operations or with your clients. Think about what new data sources you can add, because you now have the power, the processing capabilities, both hardware and software, to ask these new type of questions. And I think that's one of the key themes that we want to leave you with.
And I challenge everyone in this room to think about what hardware is it going to take to do this type of thing and to keep up with the velocity of data that we're seeing. We're talking about many, many data sources all coming together here.
Yeah.
What are the connectors for those? How can we process them in real time? How can we incrementally update our models? That is going to increasingly require new hardware and new approaches.
Yeah, and just on this one slide, it's a little bit small here. They were just examples conceptually. But if you look at the colorful graph on the right, that's, Jason, actually you coded that. That's the sentiment analysis. Mm-hmm. So that's looking at email communications that are happy, sad, angry, frustrated, cursing, derogatory, et cetera. All the things that your marketing departments do on social media to generate more sales, those things are alive and well and in use for compliance and fraud monitoring as well. Because what is it? Customer behavior is all social analytics. So is fraud. Fraud's a social behavior. And we can look at a lot at the sentiment analysis. And the other one, this map of the world, that is a global organization, a multi-billion dollar organization with worldwide sales. And when you risk score the hundreds of millions of transactions and payments that are coming out of each of those countries and scoring them, you can develop these types of heat maps to say, wait a second, we've got risks, you know, in those red countries. Maybe we should go visit those locations. And that's how companies are using these analytics, by pulling multiple data sources together.
So what we see here is the result of a recent Gartner study that looked at how analytics was being used at very large companies today. And what they found was that most of these companies were doing some sort of descriptive analytics that really addressed only the what happened, detecting certain events.
Looking backwards.
Right? Looking backwards, exactly, looking at historical data. Only 30% of those companies were really able to tell through their through their analytics why that particular event occurred.
I call that Six Sigma, the diagnostic. That was the craze of the 90s, was the whole Six Sigma stuff. That's diagnostic.
And in terms of predictive analytics, only 16% were able to really predict how those events might reoccur, or when they might reoccur, or which events might reoccur. And almost none of these companies were really able to provide, through analytics, some guidance on how to make different business decisions from that data. And for those companies that were applying analytics, almost 100% of them were looking at structured data.
Of course.
And the thing to note here, T&E analysis, access logs, whatever it might be. It comes
trading
in many forms. Trade
Anything
data,
that lives
wire
in rows
transfers,
and columns,
right?
Structure.
100% of those companies were looking at that type of data. But the important thing to note here is that only accounts for 20% of the data that's accessible to the organization. The other 80% is unstructured data. And there's so much information that can be mined from that and made part of those models and used to kind of enrich the results, that only we found only that 9% of those companies were looking at that data. So that's really where a lot of work remains to be done. That's, again, where natural language processing, text analytics comes into play. And so it's really important to be aware of that and to understand how we might be able to build software and hardware to address that part of the data, really significant.
It's funny, accountants love numbers, and we love our spreadsheets, and we're very comfortable with Excel. But what's fascinating, I mean, look at the people on the stage and the people who we're hiring now, linguistics, text miners, data scientists, et cetera. Really, it's about combining structured and unstructured. The rules of accounting, the analysis of accounting data, especially from a fraud risk perspective, are gonna change, because we're not just looking at numbers now, we're looking at text. And you'd be shocked at what people are putting in the free text fields of even a journal entry description. A payment, like I said earlier, I've seen payments described as a friend fee for thousands of dollars. Or, of course, the obvious one, Rolex watch to president of XYZ country. That's a bribe. You know? or trip to Disneyland, et cetera, which, again, if put in the right in the context of corrupt, you know, of a corrupt intent, that could be a legal violation with significant fines, like I mentioned. And that's the type of mining that we're going to incorporate in what needs to happen. And as sophistication gets improved, not just looking back historically at descriptive analytics, but going into this predictive, what's going to happen next, and even prescriptive, what should we do about it? That's going to take lots of data and lots of data sources to make sure we tune it right to eliminate the false positives. Let's go into some of these case examples as we wind up, and then we'll have about 10 minutes or so for questions.
I don't know whether you guys heard of MF Global and their collapse. They were a brokerage firm that was established in 2007 that specifically focused on complex derivatives. They kind of defined the market. But of course, they did not measure their risk properly. And soon after, in 2011, there was a really spectacular meltdown of MF Global, where they announced bankruptcy after they could not cover their own obligations, where they had some off-balance sheet investments in countries' debt, sovereign debt. And what they did, they actually wired money out of their own investors, of their own clients, to cover their obligations.
I'd say allegedly, or at least it's still in
court. Yeah, to the tune of $281 million.
And we can mention the name because it was written up in the paper that we were
actually
helping
$800
them.
$800 million or so.
So when EY got involved, we were basically asked to reconstruct the flow of these funds from the customer accounts to somewhere else. And so what we did, and we had a very short period of time to conduct this investigation.
Yeah, the regulators, are beating down the door. Same with the press.
Yeah. So we collected over 30 terabytes of data forensically. We were in there, you know, breaking locks off of server cages, pulling stuff out, bringing it back to our facility to analyze. Just an absolute overwhelming volume of data. There were over 500 custodians involved.
Which are employees.
Yeah, employees involved here.
In charge of the controlling the data.
And in some cases when we arrived, there was still, you know, a cup of coffee warm on the desk, right? And we were there, seized the computers and brought them back.
And the coffee.
And sometimes the coffee. We were definitely up late. And then the job began, right? We had to begin kind of extracting the data from these drives, mapping the data, connecting all of these different data sources, indexing the data, preparing it for the many, many different analyses that we conducted. There was, on one side of the project, a review of the data, both structured and unstructured. So we had teams of EY employees across the globe looking at actual transactional data, actual emails, and determining if it was relevant or not to the questions of the investigation. So there was roughly 3 terabytes of that that data loaded for review. A lot of what our team here in San Francisco got involved with in this was helping with the search of the unstructured data. So we worked with our investigators to really craft the types of queries that would pull back the documents that would be most relevant. Because clearly you're not going to look at every document in a 3 terabyte collection. There's just not enough eyes in the world to do that in an efficient way. And certainly not at EY.
And within 60 days.
Within 60 days, yes. That's a key factor there. So what we did was we actually combined the structured data and the unstructured data to learn what we could about where we should be focusing our efforts. So a lot of the workflow would start with transactional data, specifically wire transfers, that we identify as suspicious through the application of 100 or 200 different fraud tests that we have. Once we had isolated kind of a subpopulation, we could then use the metadata around that wire transfer to identify specific emails and email threads that would tell the bigger picture, the bigger story about why that particular wire transfer was made. Why was, you know, $3.4 million transferred out of the U.S. to the U.K. at 11:59 p.m.?
Yeah.
And what were the proper...
What's the corrupt intent?
Were the proper protocols in place? Were the proper requests and approvals in place for that? And if not, why? What happened? Leveraging the information from that structured data and finding the emails and entire discussions in some cases about that particular wire transfer was hugely, hugely useful in kind of putting together the bigger picture about, you know, what happened to the money.
Yeah.
Started here, it ended up somewhere else.
Yeah. Combining that structured and unstructured data is key. Mm-hmm. Let me get one more and we'll go quick on this one and then we'll wrap up. Here's one, this is going to remain anonymous, but imagine this big data example. Multinational organization doing a Global Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, you know, alleged high risk of paying government officials, and there were concerned, the board was concerned about potential FCPA violations. We had 120 days to collect 310 hard drives in 26 countries, 2,000 gigabytes or 2 terabytes of data loaded, over 25 million documents, 1.3 million reviewed, 2 billion financial transactions, payments specifically looked at, and the hardest part of them all, 20 different financial accounting systems. So versions of SAP over here, versions of Oracle over here. In Russia, there's a one called, I think it's called C or something. It's some other, Kazakhstan has their own ERP. What's it called?
Yeah, I think it's called C.
It's just called C. It's not the programming language. It's just their SAP over there is called C. It was amazing. But you had to analyze and look for potentially improper payments. In fact, you know, that Rolex watch example came from this, where you got to look at these high-risk transactions and then marry it up to the communications that were describing what those transactions taking place were and painting the picture by country, where do we see risks? In fact, this graphic here is an example. When I saw a word, volume contract facilitation or special payment linked to, you know, $10,000 of payments in that local currency, that's where I want to look. And those were the risk issues. And that's how we're changing the way we're doing investigations. And again, the processing power that's needed to do this, it ain't Excel anymore. It's not even, you know, it's not SQL. It's Hadoop, and it's running on these, you know, kind of an appliance fraud box, where in many cases, it's a pre-configured, preset hard box. In fact, we work with IBM and their big insights platform for Hadoop, where we have a pre-configured set of a 9-node box that can be drop-shipped on the client's site, plugged in, and the data sources can come in and we can immediately start running these tests. That's the kind of rapid responses required to meet these information demands. The last thing I want to introduce is this concept on what the SEC is doing around big data. So for those of you that are publicly traded or work with your clients who are publicly traded, this is what they're thinking about. You know, they're not immune to this. They're thinking, in fact, I know that there was an article there. They process 400 gigabytes a day of SEC, you know, 10K and filings coming in from the registrants. And imagine this. This is what they call their audit quality model. Some people call it Robocop. The media loves this. But imagine when your company submits their 10K filing or their proxy statement, it is immediately analyzed and benchmarked against other peers in your industry. And if you show up as an anomaly, it's going to flag you. Now, no one knows what the algorithms are, except, of course, the SEC. And I'm sure that's a top-kept secret. But, I mean, this is the level of sophistication, how they're bringing their game up to analyze big data. So, you know, when you think about fraud risks and risk assessments, you know, the regulators are watching this, too. And that's the key point. So as we conclude, this is what we're seeing. Remember that Andy Grove's strategic inflection point. This is a 10x factor, at least in our industry. We're going 10 times faster, 10 times more data.
At least 10 times.
At least 10
times.
Yeah,
at the minimum.
And the complexity is 10 times greater. And that gets into that Parkinson's law. Work is expanding. We're doing new tests. And again, we haven't even come up with all the tests. We're excited. I mean, we're coming up with new tests a couple every month or so. There's
we'll never come up with them all, because as Nadia said,
it's always changing.
It's always changing.
Yeah, it's an exciting field, that's for sure.
And so we need to have new models that are evolving and changing on the spot. As soon as something changes, we need the model to be able to incorporate the attributes that need to be modified, so it can predict new unknown before behaviors.
That's right. And ask new questions. And that final point, you know, the big data is not just for the marketing folks. It's alive and well for us accountants, compliance officers, internal auditors, and investigators. It's alive and well with what we're doing. So with that, that's our info if you wanted to follow up with us with any questions. And we have a couple minutes now. If you'd like to, we'll open up the questions to the audience. Yes.
Yeah, how are, I guess banks particularly, not everybody's mind, but how is the engagement model changing? They used to bring you in after something had gone wrong. How's that changing now? Are they calling you more regularly, or are they calling you in a preventative way?
Let me take that first, and then I'll let you guys comment. My book of business has really flip-flopped almost, where in the past it was more 60% reactive and 40% proactive. And truly, in the regulatory environment that our clients are in now, it's changed. 60% of my projects now are proactive, getting ahead, helping clients install better compliance monitoring programs and integrating these analytics into their organizations. And 40% is reactive nowadays. So that's a good question. It really has changed. A lot of companies are thinking way more proactively now because according to the federal sentencing guidelines that have recently been revised about 2 years ago, you get better credit if you can demonstrate due diligence, if management can demonstrate that they were actively integrating programs to reduce the risks, mm-hmm. the fines and the penalties will be less. And we've seen that time and time again.
And we've been seeing an increasing requirement on these projects that the data not leave the data center.
Yeah, right? That's true.
Whereas historically we did a lot of, what we just talked about, go collect hard drives forensically, bring them back, analyze them, and present results back. But more and more our clients are really requiring that these analytics be applied to their existing data centers, or that we bring in a fraud or anti-fraud appliance that sits kind of as a sister next to their data warehouse and allows them to also do real-time monitoring.
We're excited. In fact, we were all three at the IBM's Information on Demand Summit 2 weeks ago in Las Vegas, where we announced kind of the EY anti-fraud analytics powered by IBM Big Insights. Mm-hmm. And we're really excited about that market message that's going to have, because mm-hmm. that is the... If I could build a dream box, that's kind of what that dream box is, because it incorporates the Watson technology on machine learning and text mining that's in there. And it really is a game changer in how we go about detecting inappropriate behavior. Was there another question? Yeah, right there. Oh, here comes a mic for you. Jason or Nadia, you want to take that one?
Go ahead.
Well, we see a lot of opportunities actually with our clients around social media policy enforcement. So there's obviously social media is an overwhelming volume of data. It's a huge fire hose of data. And given that we really focus on compliance and fraud, that's one of the most obvious intersections of what we do in that particular data source. So understanding what a company's employees are posting publicly, if there's a leak of information that may be material and non-public, sensitive information, patents, patentable concepts, et cetera.
It's great for rogue traders. We've done it for rogue traders. Yeah.
And then, like, good old-fashioned HR violations as well, you'll see in social media. So those are a few of the things that we've been seeing recently.
Yeah, however, personal emails is a different story, right? There are protections around it. So if in investigation someone is implicated that, and we can show the evidence, right, that they were using their personal email inappropriately, then that would be produced in the process of investigation, but you need to have a reason to have it.
Yeah, data privacy is always kind of one consideration as we pull in these data sources.
Yeah, we look at corporate email all the time, but not necessarily personal.
Any other questions? I think we're just about out of time, but yes, sir, over here. If we can get a mic over here. Oh, good.
How do you guys measure success? Is it by dollars, the number of cases found? Analytics is great, but at the end, you've got to...
Yeah, proactively success, and funny, I was just having this conversation with a large gaming industry. Proactively, clearly, dollars recovered, arrests made, people, fraud stopped. It was an indicator. But it's interesting, when the board, these clients were telling me just 2 days ago, the board doesn't really, that doesn't really excite them, because they just expect that. What they want to see are programs. They want to see not just, hey, okay, we recovered, we saved the company $2 million in fraud schemes that we uncovered and this and that, and this guy abused his expenses. Big deal. The board's got bigger things to think about. They want to look at what programs have you installed, what perhaps data loss prevention, DLP systems have been in place or put in place, what anti-fraud training and compliance controls did you put in place, and specifically what we do, what new analytics are you doing around the organization to monitor for this stuff? Not just necessarily how many people did you fire. And that's been a big metric, proactively.
More and more of our clients are looking to us to provide guidance on how to kind of institutionalize analytics at the organization.
Yeah.
Because
make it repeatable,
almost any standard organization these days has some data analytics group or component. And many organizations have multiple analytics groups, which don't always communicate with each other. So, you know, putting a system in place, putting a shared data warehouse in place, putting together an analytics strategy that everyone can agree on, putting together a set of tests that answer all of the questions that are of interest to the board, and showing that this is something that can be used consistently
and repeatably.
Yeah,
that's been it. And again, and of course, reactive is find the bad guy. Find out what happened ASAP. Mm-hmm. And again, stop the bleeding. That's right. Or shut it down. So, that's right.
We've got one last question.
Okay.
I guess, for the people in this room, how can we help you? What's the message for the people, the technology providers in this room, to help your cause?
If I could say, think about what data you're currently incorporating or your clients are currently incorporating in their day-to-day activities, it's a great question. Think about what data that is and ask new questions of what else can we incorporate to get a better, more precise answer. And again, recognizing it's not probably fraud, it's some other metric, whether it's customer analytics or transaction processing or cost savings. But think about what new data sources that you can add and ask new questions. If you're doing the same work plan that you were doing last year or the year before, rethink it. And that's kind of what I would say is the key message. Jason or Nadia, you want to add to that?
I would say think about speed. I mean, we're seeing just an amazing increase in the volume of data. And more and more, we want to be able to apply a stack of analytics in real time to that increasing volume of data. At the same time, our clients expect things to get faster, not slower, right? So there's more data, the operations are more complex, and our clients require that it be faster. So yeah. What is it that we need to do in terms of the software and the hardware to make that happen?
And you guys can help us by cranking out faster and faster chips.
Yeah, that's absolutely on point. We don't only want to, once we detect the fraud, one thing is immediately react to it. The other thing is, once we have a storage of all of the prior patterns, we want to rebuild the models and look back, right? And to have not just store this data for the sake of it, we want to be able to reanalyze it and rebuild the models that will allow it to tell us, okay, so constantly working self-adjusting models.
Yeah, archiving and storage is a huge, huge issue. And like Nadia said, I mean, there's a lot of evidence in any data store, right? And you don't know when it might be useful, what point in the future it might be useful. So being able to immediately access it, analyze it for a different purpose, perhaps than what it was, archived for. We don't know what questions are going to be asked of that data in the future. So having hardware and software that support kind of instantaneous answers to unknown questions is really where we need to be headed.
Well, thank you guys very much for your time, and it was a privilege to speak, and good luck out there.